Welcome everybody. We are doing lesions in orthopedic conducted by under the auspices of Alkem Burjan. Let me thank Alkem Burjan and Mr. Vijay Mishra for organizing this symposium, where we are going to talk about and we are going to talk to Dr. N.S. Lad. Actually, Dr. Lad is a person who do not need any introduction. He is not just an orthopedic surgeon of a big repute. He has a lot of other facets to his personality. And in next 1 hour, me and my colleague, Dr. Sudhir Warrior, both of us have seen him for a long time, more than 30 years. And our career actually began with him and we are practicing with him. So we will try to find out the various facets of this multifaceted personality who was very fondly talked as the master. It is not a master in a master as in an English word, but master is a person who teaches in fourth standard school, in a primary school. And that's what I am quite sure he would like himself to be recognized as a teacher par excellence, because he has taught so many people, so many students that I'm quite sure many of them are there in an audience and they would like to listen to the great master once again and rekindle their memories from their school days, from their medical college days and their residency days. So let us first begin with a small video Dr. Sudhir is going to show. And Sudhir and Alkem Burjan has compiled a lot of people's, and let us see what they want to talk about this master.
His empathy for patients and the fact that he taught us that many exist because of our patients and not vice versa.
He makes you a better orthopedic surgeon, a better person, and a better human being as a whole. That's the essence of his being your guru. And I feel privileged to be his shishya. Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha.
He's a very famous teacher and he's a pioneer in back pain treatment and soft tissue balancing. And he's always interested in academics.
50 years of clinical experience, a man with a vision, a prolific teacher, a fine human being, an astute administrator, and an excellent clinician.
During his days as the head of department of Siam Hospital, he revamped the whole department with his path-breaking ideas.
His leadership capabilities and his ability to take care of his residents was the best when I worked under him at Siam Hospital.
You taught me how to use my hands under the supervision of my head. But what you really shared with me was how to use my heart to work above the head and the hands.
He is the most helpful human being and soul that I have seen. He helps anybody and everybody who asks him and goes above and beyond the call to help that person.
He is very generous, honest, and sincere to the society, his juniors and colleagues.
Recounting all our experiences with Master G during our training, after the years, is turning out an endless spot. It keeps coming from everybody from all over.
He is a stalwart and a pioneer and a surgeon par excellence in the field of root and knee arthroplasty.
I feel very honored to speak about Dr. Nandulal. I have known him for more than 45 years. Being from Indore, he is very fond of that hospital. And naturally, his favorite time is Chikanadu, Mushagari, and Chorubi.
Yes, Anish.
That's many people talking about Dr. Lad. And let's go back to the beginning. Now, at a grand young age of 82, Dr. Lad, when you look back to your earlier days, how actually did you start? And we know that many of us know that you are from a small town, which was a small town at that point of time called Indore. So how was your schooling? How was your pre-medical days? Can you tell us something about it?
First, hello all my friends and colleagues. I am so overwhelmed with your response, what you say about. So that's my pleasure. Good evening to everybody. And I'm very pleased to share my views. I don't know if I'm a legend or not, but I did meet legend like Sikin Aidu and Madhav Apte and Nandu Nartekar and Sachin Tendulkar. And I made a lot of orthopedic legends like all of you. So at the end, decide whether I'm a legend or not, but I'm still a student of orthopedics. I think, I was born in Ahmedabad. And I had schooling in Indore, which is a small place, and I was trained in a municipal school. And I think that was the good basic training. And during that school, we had a lot of good things. But I'll tell you what I wanted to be. I wanted to be an Air Force pilot or an automobile engineer, because my father was electrical and mechanical engineer. So I was very much interested in that. So it was my mother, whose brother was a gynecologist. He was from Mumbai. My mother is from Mumbai. And she insisted I should become a doctor. I should go to medicine because of my all brothers. I probably had a good career. So because of my mother, I went to medicine. But I believed that the sanskar which my parents gave me, I learned four things. Matru Devo Bhava, the mother. Pitru Devo Bhava, the father, the guideline. Acharya Devo Bhava, the teacher. And Atithi Devo Bhava, the guest. And what guest I realized? The guests overseas, where I learned a lot. My parents, we belong to a middle class family. And you will not believe that I lived with my father till his death. He was 92 and my mother was 89. So I believed in a very concept of joint family, which I still continue to do that. And I think, in my opinion, that is really very essential. So my schooling was in Indore on a government school, a high school. And then, of course, I went to medical college. I went to MGM Medical College. We had 80 students. And I was not a topper, but I was a good student. And only thing I remember was having topped in pathology in the university. But I also made a decision that I not be a pathologist.
Just tell us about your early college days in Indore.
I think early college, as I said, that not a topper, but a good student, but tremendous interest in sports. I was a very good cricketer. I played university cricket, and every ball game I played. So much so that in every college team, I was there. And in case there was a shot, I was to be called. And I never became a champion, but I was pretty good to be included into the team. I remember an instance that I continued to play cricket during my residency days in KEM, then at the corporation, and Sharma, I am your police shield, cosmopolitan shield, which doctor's team won. And I one day injured my finger while playing. And next day was a surgery day, so I went and told the patient that, I'm sorry, I had to postpone your operation because I have finger injury. So he said, Dr. Saab, aapka to khel ho gaya, humare to jaan nikal gayi. That day, I kept the bat down. I said, no, I will not play because I don't let anybody else suffer because of my game. So from that day, I stopped playing cricket.
So then, yes, Harish, you want to?
Good.
So after you finished your education in Indore, I'm really confused because when we go to Goa, you say you're from Goa. When we go to Indore, you say you're from Indore. When you're in Bombay, we feel you're a Bombayite. Finally, when did you come to Bombay? And why did you come to Bombay? And how did you...
My ancestors came from Goa, but then they went to Indore in Madhya Pradesh. Mm-hmm. So my cousin speaks Hindi. But I decided to come to Mumbai for one reason. I had good marks there. I could have continued after MBBS as a register, houseman and registrar, and then made my career. But I felt that, there was All India Physicians Conference. And as a general secretary, I was in charge of it. And I was very impressed with the physician group which came from Mumbai. And I said, I must have a training here, because what training I had and what my residents could do, the young doctors who had come from Bombay impressed me. Second thing, my maternal uncle also was from GS Medical College. And for my holiday, they used to come to Parel. So KEM was an attraction. So I decided that, no, I will go to Mumbai and pursue my career in Mumbai. So I decided to come. And in November 62, I left Indore after my internship and came to Mumbai. I came to Mumbai. I believed in one thing, never sit at home. So where to get a job? So there was a job in Bombay Hospital in Neurosurgery Department under Dr. Ginde and Dr. Bhagwati. So I went and joined it. When I joined that, I was very impressed with their precision work, dissection, dedication, stamina. But the morbidity and mortality shook me, because neurosurgery that time was not very advanced. So while I was doing that, one day I read an advertisement that there is a post in KEM in dressing department. So then I said that let me go to dressing department. One principle I have in life, I don't rate anybody to be less than you. And believe me, I learned how to do dressing from a boy named Dattu, because he used to do such an excellent dressing. And second thing I learned was that patient who keep on doing dressing, drug infection doesn't heal. So there is a cause. So I learned that time, infection, if the patient continues to have, learn and find out the cause. Otherwise, you keep on dressing. But I will never forget the way I could dress the elbow, the shoulder, because of what I learned from Dattu.
We all really remember the care you used to take in the wards to see that all the patients had wonderful dressings. But that means you were not an orthopedic surgeon when you came to Bombay.
No, I was registered in KM Hospital for jaw surgery. Mm-hmm. Then I got an opportunity to JJ Hospital. I worked in JJ Hospital under Vernon De Silva, Patel and Shroff. Did 6 months general surgery post in JJ. And JJ, you know, they used to do general surgery plus orthopedics. But what reduction technique I saw from Dr. De Silva was European, and I was shaken up. But JJ Hospital, there was one very good thing JJ Hospital. Hospital residents born homie, because a lot of foreign residents were there, and they were very of open mind. So even JJ, I made a lot of friends. And so after 6 months, I was again looking out, and there was an advertisement of orthopedic externee in KM Hospital. So I said, okay, let me do that. Externee means you work from 8 to 12, and then you go home. So I applied for that, and I was very keen. But after about a week, I was told that no, the local student has taken it over. Now I accepted that, yes, it is his right to take who am I come from outside. But I always kept one thing, never think yourself outside. Make efforts that you will be considered inside. But to my luck, that doctor got another job and I got externee's post. That's how I entered the world of orthopedics. And I was posted in Dr. A.K. Talwalkar's unit. And I had decided that if I had to make a career, I had to make friends with my residents. And we had, you know, the famous Dr. Thirte, plastic surgeon, Dr. Talwalkar's son, Dr. Jerige, and all from Belgaum. Satish Modi was there, and so we all of our were residents. But what I did was, I used to hang around, because KM was huge work, big OPD, and alternate day operation theater and surgery. I was very impressed with Dr. Talwalkar, because his approach was very different. And looking to, you know, my dedication and my work all the time, he asked me one day, why did you change to orthopedics? I said, sir, I cannot get the registration. And Sudhir, I owe it to him that he phoned and I got orthopedic registration. And Sudhir, that's how I was late by 6 months to take my MS. Second thing I was impressed with him was his technique of orthopedic surgery. And I had the fortune of assisting him for orthopedic, your Austin Moore orthoplasty. I was very convinced with his technique of square nails and his V and femoral nail. Sudhir, I still feel ischemic fractures well reduced, those old nails can work. But that does not mean that we should not progress. But I learned from him that reduce it, put them together, mobile, move the moon, no pain, it will heal. So he believed in that. Now what happened that time, I forgot to tell all of you, there was RMO strike in KEF. And in that strike, naturally my habit of meddling in these affairs of students, my name came in the committee and I was not continued. So I got a job in Siam Hospital. That's how I landed up in Siam Hospital in 1963. And that Siam Hospital post which I got, I was lucky because after 1 year in KEM, I got a registrar's post. At that time, Siam was not medical college. It's not medical college. There were only two units. And Babulkar was with me, you know, Babulkar from Nagpur, he was with me. Sancheti was with me in Mumbai. He was my registrar when I was with Talwalkar, he also remembers. So that time, if you know, Siam Hospital actually was converted from military hospital into a medical college. And medical college started in 65. So then what happened? The MCI recognition had to be there. So if you need MCI, because you must bring in the senior people with experience. That's how I came in touch with Dr. Katral. And we used to live in the barracks. You know, there are no RMO's hostel. Here I was impressed with this old man because he was very kind, affectionate, and also two radical people I saw. Dr. Katrak, a surgery master at non-operative treatment, and Talwalkar, the father of orthopedic surgery. Now, Sudhir, I want to remember one more thing. You are talking about Ponseti's technique. You know, we as a resident put in effort. Dr. Katrak used to do that tenotomy and plaster correction beautifully. And he was awarded in 57 Honorary Fellowship of British Orthopedic Society, the only in Asia. But we that time never had had that ability to publish. Otherwise, that work would have been pioneering work. And this was from 1957, imagine. So two things I learned from Dr. Katra. One thing, in difficult situation, try to be godly, don't try to be God. And second, when you pick up a knife, make a prayer. Oh Lord, let me be the last operation. A very kind and a good person. So Siam Hospital, I began extremely on a fair note.
You have made us realize that these two tenets of yours percolate through each and every one of us. And many of us do remember that each time we're doing, when we wash up for surgery, we remember that let this be the last surgery for this.
Very important.
For some reason, because of your capability and being a sportsman and being a leader, anytime there was any disaster, why was it that you were the first fellow who wanted to always run and help?
So then it was like this, you know, the time teaches you, the difficult situation teaches you. Two things happened. In 1967, two trains collided in Matunga. And there were 279 insured and 73 deaths. And these 73 bodies, which we had form a torso, here two limbs. How many died, we do not know. And that time, it all chaos. We worked for 10 days, morning till evening. I learned to do burhole. I learned to put a chest tube. I explored the abdomen. And there were surgeons who did a brilliant job. And 79 injured, we were all lost what to do. And then time he said that something needs to be done. Because, you know, Siam is located at the entrance of the Mumbai. It caters for two international airlines, two national railway lines, and two expressways. So all the injuries used to come there. So we had to do something. In 67, I was called by the dean that there was a famine in Bihar. And that time, Vice Chancellor Gajendra Gadkar has asked to send a doctor's interns team. Unfortunately, the social movement to medicine professors, mainly ladies, they refused. So Dean asked me, so I led that team. And so then, you know, with whom I worked, you'll be surprised. That's how I became humble. 6 weeks I worked with Jay Prakash Narayan.
Oh, wow.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I said that how this great man is a very good human being, but how he cannot be a prime minister, because he was very emotional man, very, very emotional man. And that time, you know, I was staying in Ravi Shankar Maharaj's ashram. And with me, you know who was there? Arvind Mafatlal.
Oh.
Lal Bhai Dalpat Bhai. Yeah. And we used to sit in line and eat. Mm-hmm. Such were great people. They were legends. They were legends. So I learned humility from them. And I learned how to live for people from them. But that Siam trauma told me one thing. The way we are going today, that time, will not work. We have to do something. We have to do something. So what was that? So I must say that there was one professor of surgery named Narkar who said that we must have these selected trauma cases which are moderately injured and which are salvageable. We must have a concept of intensive care in trauma ward. And that was the genesis of the trauma ward, where on the basics of the trauma culture, what they had in Baltimore, the Siam Hospital established the emergency trauma care ward. And main injury being general surgery, resuscitation, that is anesthetics, general surgery for visceral injury, and skeletal injury orthopedic surgery. So all of us were posted there, and we had to work not as general surgery or trauma, as orthopedic, but as a trauma surgeon. So we learn how to put intratracheal tube. We also learn how to put a chest tube. And we also know how to give and that time, you know, exophyx center was not there. But we thought of something needs to be done. So that was a genesis of E-Ward. And so here, two things, another thing very important I'll tell you. Our concept of casualty is not correct. You know, in most of the colleges, what is casualty? It is located at a distant place. It is manned by a doctor who is not trained. It has a sister who has just come back from her delivery. And we have a ward boy who is drunk. And most of the time, you go to casualty department and then they have a cup of tea, because that's where it is available 24 hours. So we must change that casualty to accident emergency. So A&E, that was the concept all over the world. So accident emergency and trauma ward concept, intensive care, was the main thing which was good at Siam Hospital. And that's the reason Siam Hospital made a big mark in India. And so you trace it. You know, I would say that by having future opportunities to go to AO and all, because Siam Hospital,
at that time, sir, you were extremely fortunate at that time, or maybe the boys who were with you were so fortunate, because that change that was happening at Siam Hospital, where suddenly you looked at trauma as a completely different and a separate entity, you had with you really people with fire in their bellies.
Outstanding, outstanding.
And I think,
you know, many times, Sudhir, they pushed me. I should push them, but they pushed me. There we had the concept of a teamwork. What is together, everybody can achieve more. Right. So, yes. So that's how now. And look, Sudhir, each of them established themselves not only nationally, but internationally. These were the gems. This was the department. Sudhir, if you look to today's heads of the department of successful faculty members, 1/3 will be from this group. 1/3 will be from this group, because you see, I tell you the story of a hand surgeon who had come here from Switzerland. And he, with Dr. Joshi, you know, we had associated, showed a thumb distractor. So I invited him to my house. And when I invited him, he said, my wife is not with me. So I said, doesn't matter. In India, guest is welcome. So when I went to him, he called me in Switzerland to his house. And his wife served us, and I saw some facial phone. This I asked him, who is she? So she said that she is the president of Switzerland. I was taken aback. Look, the lady who served as president, India's president, won't move his bottom. Now, what message I got? Because he gave me a message. He asked me, you know, Nandu, who is the highest paid man in Switzerland? So I said, the corporate chairman. He said, no, primary school teacher. Mm-hmm. Now, Sudhir, what position? Teacher must have that position. A society will achieve. That's why the guru is very important. And if you have a good guru, then naturally you have a direction. So you have good guru, you have excellent students, you are willing participants, and then you go as a team. And that's how in Sion Hospital, our biggest of disasters, road accident, bomb blast, we learn the organization of disaster management.
So the same students whom you trained during that time rushed when the Bhuj earthquake happened. Shekhar came in with his team. Narayan came in with his team. The same people led
their team. Yes.
It just shows that you were able to bring into them the same kind of
enthusiasm, commitment,
society, and commitment. And that seems to have gone absolutely perfectly.
Same thing happened in the Latur earthquake.
Right, sir.
And today, as you see, Sudhir, why are we in a messed up? Because of the organization. You know, when you are in disaster, there are three A's. Anticipate, act, and avoid. What happened? We should have anticipated this in January and acted. That doesn't matter. And second thing was the right thing to do. Take the right person to right place in right time to save life and save limb. That's what we did from the organization point of view. So, Sion Hospital, when initially the mass casualty used to come, we used to have a problem in getting theater, everything about 4 to 5, 6 hours. Sudhir, in 10 years' time, before the bomb blast, do you know what was the initiation time? 45 minutes. We could empty the ophthalmic ward, the ENT ward, the tuberculosis ward, and could receive 200 bomb blast patients.
Wow.
Within our 15 minutes.
Wow.
So it's an organization. Disaster management is an organization. And that that I learned leadership. But, you know, a leader, see, in a disaster management, there's one rule. It's like a war. And war is fought by army of soldiers and one general. Unfortunately, what we are seeing is, today we are fighting the war with army of generals. So that was very important. Second protocol. And mind you, many of these colleagues of mine, they set up a protocol, including infection diseases protocol. Also, they had done a lot of innovation related to the various treatment modalities where we can easily do. And there in Sion Hospital, because we had this, and I had this kind of a team who was keen to do, I made a lot of efforts to get instrumentation, because our difficulty was like Bombay policeman who was fighting smugglers with 303 rifles against the AK-47. We are doctors, we are using tools of 1950s to treat injuries of 1975 or 80. So that's where I felt that it was very necessary now to look beyond that. How do we learn the state of art of doing this surgery?
I do remember, sir, from that time, I do remember the fact that, if I mistake not, the first AOSET in Mumbai came to you.
Yes.
And that was surprising. Surprising. We were sitting in JJ and watching this happen, and we were surprised that the government is giving you all the first AOSET. that's not even KEM.
That's a very interesting story. You know, Sudhir, when I said I want that, the clerk said, put 4 notes. Is it necessary? Can you manage without it? Is it available in other hospitals? Is civil work necessary? And how otherwise you can do it? So it went to next man. He wrote the same thing. Went to third man. So ultimately it went to the commissioner. And it took me about 20, 30 visits at odd time to go and convince them. The last minute we had a dean named Dr. Professor. He was a physiologist. But so he said, okay, doctor, let me see. Commissioner said what I can do. So he turned back and said, he said, sir, I presume that you are getting your daughter married. He said, yes. He said, sir, please don't ask them to print the invitations. They will ask, how was she managing before? can alternative arrangement be made? So that's how the corporation works. But perseverance. I will not leave. And mind you, when we got that, you know what we got? Not only we got instrumentation, but we got a trauma unit. And in that trauma unit, you know, Shekhar Kunta was the first lecturer. He was a unique, absolutely unique. Only problem was he was like an AK-47 gun. He used to sleep for 2 or 3 hours, and rest of the time he'll think about that. But then we showed that we reduced morbidity, we reduced mortality, we restored function. So state of our treatment, how to do it, we learned about it.
So you then got curiously from all this, public service, you suddenly went to the highest end of orthopedics, to the elitist. You went to the AO and you made such big ripples in AO. They became waves and they engulfed the entire country. And you brought the basic and the advanced course.
It was like this. I'm always keen to learn and I'm still very much a student. You know, Professor Mohan Das was the person who brought AO to India. But AO actually went to Ahmedabad first. And they had a course and I had gone there. I was very impressed. So they were very radical. And the surgeries they were doing were very, very, you know, specific. Mainly the training, instrumentation, design, and execution and soft tissue response was very. Only thing which I was moved that time and I continued to do that was their terminology of rigid fixation. So this rigid word I don't like, because I feel rigidity of anything in life is bad, whether it is attitude or sex. It has to be stable. Why rigid? Because anything rigid, you fix it, the bone will go to sleep. You know, my friend Manu Kota used to say, it needs a stimulus. But then I made a decision that this is the thing which probably needs, all Indian needs, because of two things. The injuries we saw and failures I analyzed in our documentation in fracture follow-up clinic and hand follow-up clinic. So I invited Professor Willenegger, Professor Weller, Professor Holtz and admission to Sion Hospital. And you know, Sudhir, what we showed them? We showed them our fixation devices and our failures with the implants we used. And also my keenness to let them know that India also can think about innovative things. I introduced them to B.B. Joshi. And you know, they were so impressed with his handwork and with his hand splints. So that time, that's how I came in touch with AO. And to my surprise, they invited me to be a trustee on AO Foundation. And Professor Weller, one fine day, told me that I run a light AO fixator treatment, research in India and Brazil. And we did 150 cases and also showed it was a light tube-to-tube fixator, external fixator. And you know, it gave very good results. Then because of cost, they dropped it. But you know, Sunil, these all what I spent my time with AO was unbelievable. You know, I interacted with Mervyn Kyle, with David Helfand, and
I remember when you used to come back from there, we used to look forward to all the material you carried in your bag.
Yes.
We could read what was going on because there was no access to all of that.
Yes, yes.
And I came across this absolutely wonderful gem.
Written
to you by Dr. Jesse Jupiter.
Yes.
Other than Jesse Jupiter, saying Diego Fernandez and I express our deepest regards and great respect for all that you have done and continue to do in India and in the AO Foundation. You had a great friend in Jesse Jupiter, whom I meet every year and who pays his regards to you each year. So you really created an impact.
No, really, really thanking. But you see what happened that when they talked about these small hand plates, I said, why is it that every 3 years you show us a plate and convince it is very good? And then call goes by 3 times. Why is it so? Are there not alternative methods which we can do? And I felt that looking to cost, effectivity, patient acceptance, and the surgeon's ability to do it in average place. something else to be needs to be done for hand surgery. But I was very impressed with J.P. Jupiter. You know, I did raise controversies. See, that is my nature. I don't know why. Because if invention is necessity is mother of invention, controversy is the key to progress. So I think to be controversial is not too bad.
You also played a key role in bringing pelvis injuries into the limelight. Sir, I remember as a student when we used to come to your department to see cases from JJ, I remember Ram Chedda showing us a patient with an external fixator on the pelvis, which we had not seen at all. It looked like something from outer space.
You see, Sion Hospital had very, very bad injuries. And I remember that Dr. Chaubal did a acetabular fixation on a doctor whose results was very good. And when we got a lot of those cases, we said, we need to do it. And do you know Chandu Thakkar, Dr. Thakkar, my friend, who is now in the United States, a good orthopedic surgeon. You know, he showed, he was with him. So I said, Chandu, we must do that. And you know, when we did it, 1976. And his work and our work on acetabulum almost was so recognized. And Sudhir, I felt that this excellent fixator was life-saving. And it was so easy to do. So we concentrated on acetabulum pelvic fractures and collected cases and conducted workshops. Sudhir, you know, when I retired, what the best present given to me was a pelvis with external fixator and a plate on the pubis, DHS, and posterior fixation. I was over him. And then what do they write? Salute the master.
Yes.
So ultimately, from a professor, they made me a primary school master. Sir, you may have done big thing, but you are ultimately a primary school teacher. Mm-hmm. Anyway, I was, you know, these gifts, Sudhir.
If you're in Switzerland, you have to earn more then.
I don't know, Harish.
As a primary teacher.
I would earn more. But I'll tell you, since you talked about Switzerland, you know, when I was your trustee, once there is a issue and toast, you raise a toast to your success to be one of the AO Foundation member, 97 peer professors from 101 countries. So I said, what can I raise? I raise a toast that I could achieve this because I had peace at home. And there will be applause.
Mm-hmm.
So I said, why was that? So Professor Algover went and told me, says, Professor Nath, you know what you said? There are fellows here who have married three times and are still alone. So, you know, my wife has a big contribution because I really had the way she looked after my children. I would have not been able to achieve one-tenth if she was not with me. And also my parents who did not back me. But she's not a doctor, but a simple human being, but full of empathy, full of understanding, and tremendous amount of tolerance. And many people say that how she has lived with me all these years, because it's difficult to live with such a madman who just gets lost and carried away. So that's how it is. But Sunil, it's a fact of life. But so now this COVID has helped me to be with her, to watch television.
She must be praying that COVID came about 25, 30 years ago, so you would stay home for much longer. But
You're right. I think it should have come. You know why? Because we used to go to holidays because I said, let me settle, we'll earn big money and then we'll go to holidays. If that was 45, 50 years ago, me and my wife both would be young, you know. So my friends, young fellows, so do things at right time.
Absolutely.
Spend holidays. Absolutely. Because you will get money. You'll get everything.
You will not be young.
Understand?
There's this message that has come from someone who did exactly that.
River which allows everyone to use its resources without discrimination, without expectation. A river which we all worship.
Amazing. He encapsulates all those characteristics and all those properties that emanated from you that he's learned, that you're like a
he's a gem of a friend. You know, I spend a lot of good time. And you know what? His elder son has become a very good orthopedic surgeon in the United States. The other way, I heard his webinar. Mm-hmm. And I was really moved. That mm-hmm. boy must not be even mid-30s, not even 30s, but mid-30s, but achieved. I think this is something very, very important. Very important. When you see your own colleague succeed in second generation, that gives you such an amount of satisfaction which you cannot buy with money. Don't buy with money.
So not many people know that you, many people do obviously know that you were the president of the Bombay Orthopedic Society, the Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, the Indian Orthopedic Association, and there's
the Indian Arthroplasty Association.
Not many people know that you were the president of the Indian Society for Surgery of the Hand, and not many people know that Ranawat also started out as a practically like a hand surgeon and has a lot of publication in hand. I really wonder how you took an interest in hand. And how Dr. B.B. Joshi came into your life?
See, that is a necessity. In Sion hospitals, you get a lot of injuries. You know, people come in with neglected trauma from farm injuries, you remember? Right. And my associate, Dr. Joshi, what I saw, I was so impressed. Actually, I ran a hand surgery follow-up clinic with Dr. Ravin Thakte, plastic surgeon and physiotherapist. And I remember that we had more than 2,500 cases we could salvage hand, bring in hand function. And Sudhir, do you know that also addition to hand surgery, what we learned that these people with hand surgery would change their personality and we have to give them psychotherapy to restore function. So those patients who didn't have any psychotherapy could not get good function, but when acute cases, they were counseled very well, they got excellent results. And then, of course, my association with Dr. Joshi. But most surprising thing I learned in orthopedics, which not many people now do also, of a brilliant concept of Professor Manu Kothari. You know, Professor Manu Kothari was an eminent anatomist from KM Hospital. And his concept was soft tissue is everything. Bone forms into soft tissues. You are in the womb of mesenchyme. And all what you to do, so he gave that concept. And you know our distraction techniques, Elizaro technique, and also acute trauma and neglected trauma. Today, if you use distraction and align the soft tissues, you see a bone remodeling. So then just look up. So my association with B.B. Joshi was three reasons. The man was human, intelligent. He used local ingenious, innovative ideas to cure and also believed in cost. And so we need to now have a balance between what you have in abroad and what we can do. That also learned from Talwalkar, who started INR. So with Dr. Joshi, we developed a mini external fixation system. And that was genesis of a boy from Indo known as Vinod Arora, who showed a concept of plug. You know, you must give credit to the people who did all that. Sir, and we developed this. So B.B. Joshi, yes.
If I might just interrupt, it's so rare that somebody remembers Vinod Arora after 30, 35 years. Vinod has
one thing, remember in life, never take away anybody's credit. You don't become big. You become big by making other men as big as you are. And then you are in his company, so you become big.
I'm sure it's a very happy day for Vinod Arora that you spread this information to so many people.
The thought process, because he got a crushed thumb.
Absolutely.
And he didn't have anything in Indore. See, this Indore business with me has stayed too long, you know. Too long, this Indore business. So he used it for a thumb. Then with Dr. Joshi developed it. But then later on what happened, I said that we should have attitude like Japanese. If they make anything, they use for the word use. That's why we had some problem running with the JS about loosening and other things about the metal. So we got into collaboration with the Shishud Surgicals and Adler and scientifically produced with a teardrop concept. You are one of the designers in that and also a null rod so that would get a. And you know, Sudhir, I tell you, it's such a handy and useful thing. It is light, an application from pediatrics to geriatrics. And it is so cost effective. I know there are new technologies now. I don't deny that. But there are areas, and remember, the world, what percentage of world African, Afro-Asians can afford today's fragment-specific devices? Can they have an environment to operate? Do they have facility to operate? Do they have teachers to teach? But this is something, it's like a mechano, which stimulates the brain of human being. And they play around with it and do modification. And so there many times when we did this workshop, you know, young boys from various parts of India would come out with what they have used and shown good results, including shoulder fractures, ankle fractures, tibial plateau fractures. And I still feel that there has to be open discussion as to how even this works. If you follow the basic fundamentals of group diagnosis, perfect reduction, interfragmental fixation, neutralization by a device. And Sudhir, I tell you, you get excellent results. Excellent results. Unbelievable. You take out the device and you have no keloid, you have no infection. So I think it's a good tool in hands, particularly, and mind you, you give it to the young residents. You know, these young people are so ingenious, that you'll be surprised as to how they pull out difficult cases. And for open injuries of peripheral extremity, I think is one of the useful tools.
It still is unsurpassed in its indications in some places. But sir, moving on. Yes, Harish.
Dr. Lahr, you started from trauma in Sion Hospital.
Yeah.
And then you went for hand surgery, then went for UMEX. From all that thing, how did you jump to arthroplasty surgery? Because you are today known as an arthroplasty surgeon who was a part of a team operating on the Prime Minister of India. I mean, that's a huge jump. And even today, people are trying to segregate, like Sudhir does only hand, I do only arthroplasty, somebody does only spine. And you had done all, and not just done all, but reached a pinnacle in all of these things.
Harish, is again the indoor connection. You will laugh, all of you will laugh, indoor connection. You know, Ranawat was my 3 year senior, 4 year senior, and we played cricket together. 74, I went, my brother had cancer, to America, and I saw Ranawat doing a duocondylar knee and totocondylar knee, 1974. And I said that, will this have an application? So I came back and talked to Dr. Pulakia. He said, no, Nandu, I don't think it will come for the knee. We least forgot that the old population in India at that time was less than 50%. Today, Harish, the elderly population in India is almost 13%. And many of them live up to 80, 85. So this concept of knee replacement, so I said, we need to learn this. We must always have open mind, always do an open mind. And you know how the opportunity came? The opportunity came in 1980, there was Silver Jubilee of Indian Orthopedic Association. And we had the first interaction from operative field to the outside. And Dr. Ranawat interacted and showed. Dr. Golakia was also there. So we could see, and that time we had no solution for ankylosing, for avian, for infections, for trauma, and we had to do something. And girdle stone operation, bilateral, Harish, was not a good idea. So we had to learn that. You know what Ranawat did? Having come here and saw this, I had talked with him. So he donated 5,000 joints to Bombay Hospital, to Sancheti Hospital, and to Choitram Hospital in Indore. And we ran that time 14 workshops on joint replacement. That's how it picked up. But necessity to do offer a pain-free joint without shortening to restore full function and arthritis was a very good idea. Least we forgot that India's problem is not so much hip, but the knee. And do you know, Harish, the knee probably was a thing. And at, just now you mentioned that I had the good fortune of being a team where we together operated on the Prime Minister. That gave a flip. I look back, we used to do 2,000 knees, 2,000 hips and knees in 1988. Today, it is 180,000 knees and about 60, 70,000 hips, maybe more. I don't know. I'm not operating now. So this was futuristic. What was more futuristic was ensure that we train the people, because orthoplasty is a very dangerous operation. If you do good, it is everything. If it fails, it's a disaster. So Dr. Ranawat used to come that time to do surgeries, and I used to help him to do surgeries at Beach Candy Hospital. And our Prime Minister, Atal Bihari Vajpayee, had severe bilateral knee pain. And he was seen by many surgeons and advised to go abroad. And one day, he had gone to United Nations and got excruciating pain. So they contacted. So I talked to Chip. Chip said, our friend Raskina, you know, from KM?
Vijay Raskina.
So he asked Raskina to go and give him an injection. Raskina gave him the injection. You know, PM would deliver his famous speech in Hindi at the United Nations. He made a decision. He told Ranawat, no, I will get operated in India, not in America. I don't believe in it. Look at the man's personality. So there were a lot of offers from South India and Delhi and everybody to offer. But he chose, Ranawat chose Breach Candy because he had a team here. I was here, Sanchedi was here. We were with him for a long time. We had an ROC training doctors. So he chose Breach Candy Hospital. And we operated on the Prime Minister. The Prime Minister was extremely pleased. And when his second knee gave trouble, he said, again, I want to do it in Mumbai. And it was done in Mumbai. So Harish, that's the story of a great man. Particular to get surgery done in our own country by our own people. And next time the Donald didn't bring his team. The team, us. And Harish remembers he had done a fellowship with Ranawat. So naturally, Harish was there. And we had done that time surgery on him, and he was extremely pleased.
The joints is again upper end, advancing age, etc. And then you come back home after a joint replacement, and then you go to Shushrusha Hospital, which is a cooperative movement. And there is a question from one of the from one of the viewers, and the question is about from Sanjeev Kumar from Gopalganj, who says, how's your idea of the cooperative hospital working? Where did you get into this?
Sudhir, I'll tell you. I said, today we have jump hospitals which are crowded. We are unable to give perfect treatment. As against that, we have corporate hospitals in Mumbai, two apart, free, but not treatment in time and quality, and good, very expensive. There is nothing in between. All these years in small areas, they could have small nursing homes. But today's injuries, today's legal part, it's very dangerous to do surgeries and individual. It binds you down, doesn't give you free time, and it's a multi-speciality. Second thing, even as a young man, you remember I had no facilities, I couldn't bear nursing home. And that time Dr. Randive had this concept. What is the concept of cooperative hospital? The concept is you take healthcare as a right without exploitation by self-participation. Whose problem is healthcare? Is it government's problem? Corporate's problem? It's a citizen's problem. So if citizens come together and start a hospital, then they can offer cost-effective treatment. And member gets a concession in treatment and fixed procedural charges. And beauty is between Mediclaim, where when you fill Mediclaim, they take away all the money. And then don't do full money, you have to renew it. This membership, you don't have to renew it. It's a one-time investment and lifetime benefit. It covers husband and wife and offers 25% relief to the senior citizens. So then imagine this city of Mumbai, which had this cooperative hospital. Mumbai has 30 suburbs. These 30 suburbs had 200-bedded hospital. We had 60,000 beds. Maharashtra has a great tradition of cooperative. So cooperative means all specialties, and cooperative hospital dean is always a doctor, and doctors being shareholders call shots.
I remember the fact that though I'm now attached to various big hospitals, but my first attachment was Shushrusha, and it's been my dearest attachment simply because when I was nobody, you gave me that chance.
Yeah.
And the hospital continues to give young people a chance to come out and get their careers going in the cooperative hospital. Absolutely wonderful concept.
Let me play the devil's advocate here, Sudhir. I have been working in Shushrusha for last maybe 25 years since I came back from England. Then the first attachment, as you said, I had. What I realized is Shushrusha of cooperative hospital concept is extremely good. It is important. But there has to be somebody like Dr. Lad who can stand there and who can work selflessly to make it happen, because just people coming together doesn't make the thing happen. You have to have somebody who can give up his practice sometime and then give up his own patient and may suffer some financial loss himself. But he has to be there to get that whole thing ahead. So that leadership has to be there. Otherwise, we do have a lot of cooperative farming and other sectors. There are a lot of cooperative sugar factories. How many farmers are really very happy? So just having a cooperative doesn't help. I think you need to have somebody like Dr. Lad who has to be there. Absolutely. So how do you achieve that? I mean, that is more important question.
If we get a leadership like Harish and Sudhir and all others, but I tell you, the things are different. But you know, post this tragedy, what's going to happen? Mm-hmm. Hospitals like this, which are owned by the people, of the people, will be one of the big solutions. And Harish, I'll tell you, because we do not have only 23,000 membership. If I had 150,000 membership, I would have corpus of 150 crores. 150 members, I could control 6 corporation seats, 2 MLA seats, and 1 member of the parliament. You know, the political part of it. But one mistake I did was, I did not get this politicized. It became completely apolitical. Because this institute, and look at what happened. 5 years ago, a donor came and gave me 25 crores. So I could build another hospital in Mumbai suburbs, a 140-bedded super specialty hospital. Sudhir, do you know, Harish? We handed it over to corporation on 26th of March, anticipating that Bombay is going to have a big trouble. And that was the first dedicated COVID hospital in eastern suburbs of Mumbai. All other corporate hospitals give 20 beds, 30 beds, 40 beds. But this was, in Mumbai, probably the full 140-bedded COVID hospital.
Absolutely wonderful. Absolutely
wonderful.
So the Shushrusha movement is moving on. There's a small question from Jairam Jagyasi that how were you at 2 places at the same time? How do you time yourself? Because you're all over the place. Because I remember in the evenings, long, long ago, in the evenings, you would disappear somewhere to do some social work. And that used to happen in the night.
Yeah, I think it's not a social work. It's a social commitment to it.
Mm-hmm.
Let me tell you an incident in my life which I'll never forget. You know, we children, you know, scavengers who clean our toilets and clean Bombay roads. There is a person named Ramesh Halankar. He came and met me and he told me one day, he said, sir, these children live in one room. They can't study. They have a big problem. Sir, something can be done. So I want your help. So what we did, I approached the municipal commissioner. And the municipal schools used to get over by 4:35. So we advised, I went and requested them, can we use this after 6:30 or 7? Till about 9 for these children to study. So then we started with 40 students. I was associate for about 15 to 20 years. You will not believe at the end of 10 years, we could have their own boy coming as a teacher and teaching them. And then that time also I encouraged them and told them that you have a talent about music, dance. And do you know one of the girls, very smart girl, not only she succeeded in the TV show, she was given the role of Shivaji's wife and became a TV actor. She was daughter of a scavenger.
Wow.
The problem is the father takes drinks because of horrible working. The mother sells vegetables. So Sunil, if you really see that, and it is so surprising and shocking that after I left, they closed down that system because they could not pay electricity bills.
Oh my God.
So really, there are a few things in my life as to I feel why. And, you know, Sunil, many times question comes because I did not have the political power. I don't know whether if I had the political power. Mind you, I did try, because I was called one time that you can take the ticket. Yes, Harish?
Yeah, what we all realize looking at you is you don't need to be really very intelligent, but you must have a lot of empathy if you want to become a successful doctor, because you must feel that there is a problem in a society and you must be the first guy to lead and go there to do something about it, because maybe you are better equipped to help people who are, you know, troubled by any kind of a trauma.
You are absolutely correct. Very intelligent, feels he is the only wise man. Average man with empathy has an ability to listen, ability to communicate, ability to understand people's power. And then you do that. See, the conditions put in, I don't think I could have accepted that at that time. You know, it's unfortunate I missed Rajya Sabha, president's nominee. You know, the political people take it away, but I have no grief. I would have, if I had given a chance, I don't think politics is bad, Sudhir. I think good people should go to politics. But life is politics, because you know your daughter more, love your daughter more than your son. That's politics. See, that's politics, you know.
Sudhir is laughing. Actually wondering, I mean, I am on the receiving side here sometime, that you are everywhere. What about your family? Do you spend time with them? How do you?
My lifetime's possession is not money. Hmm. My lifetime possession is my family, my grandchildren. You know, I feel life is worth living with diabetes and all the difficulties around the world because of my granddaughters. Imagine, you know, just imagine a situation that she tells you that, Grandpa, we are going to have today the Chinese and you're going to pay for it. Okay? And it's a pleasure. So it's always the rule. And you know what I did was, I said that you must have a hobby. So I have created a farmhouse. I have a farmhouse about 89 kilometers. And you know, as an orthopedic surgeon, we talk about the plant. It's good to be in vicinity of the plants. And do you know, my caretaker was the best professor I had teaching about the agriculture. How to plant, how to water, how to have lawn, how to make nice lawn. So there, no small person is smaller. In his profession, he's really very good. But what I did was, there is a river. When we go there, these my little children take me into the river. And then we all sit in the flowing river. And one of my grandsons and my nephews tell me that put that beer bottle in water and drink that cold beer. So it's not question. Sudhir, you know, small things, how you get such an amount of pleasure. And these small children, the way I've seen them growing, do you know, Sudhir, they have very poor impression about my intelligence. They said, you don't know how to operate computer. You don't know how to use your phone. My grandson is 14 year old.
Sir, I would disagree with them, sir. This was on your 75th birthday, the left side photograph. You're with Alex and you're learning to use the new software that is going to create car.
80th birthday. 80th birthday.
80th birthday. And on the Sudhir, right.
I have, you know, Alex is going to get tired. Because he's not going to be such a dumb student. Who has, of course, I'm trying. Every day I'm trying. My granddaughter teaches. But I think your ability to absorb becomes less. And second thing, sometimes there are few inhibitions. You have so many distractions to think about here, there, why the things are going wrong. I read a lot of newspaper, a lot of articles, and keep on thinking about it. But yes, not only that, I want to learn. I was an artist, you know, 1961 college. I was even the best talented artist. And I used to act in drama, and also I used to sing. And, you know, many of the orthopedic parties, you know, I had done that satire based on film this. These boys sometimes make me dance. But anyway, I feel dancing is a good thing. It gives you physical fitness. It brings people near you. And I've seen in the audience when you talk about big subjects and everything, people sitting at the end cannot interact with you or they are shy. But in case you're dancing, he's next to you. And then he's open to ask you whatever he asks you. And there you see, you get four things. You are relaxed. You are out of your tension. You get physical fitness. You feel hungry. You have good appetite. And then you enjoy your cocktail. So that's next day morning,
so that you go. That brings me to a very important question that I can't ask you face to face, sir. What is your best drink, sir? What do you like the best?
Sir, I'm not, but I personally feel I'm that way dumb in the science art of alcohol. But I think that single malt, my friend Mukund Thatte told me how to drink. I used to add soda to single malt. He said, sir, what are you doing? What a nonsense. You are worse than a villager. So then he told me, you take a peg of single malt, the same amount of water. So then I think that's right. Huh? That's very correct. Mm-hmm. So there is science in drinking also. Mm-hmm. Right? Science and art in drinking. So as a student, you should do that. But I don't drink every day. But I like my drink.
Which brings us very close to the end of this interview. It's been a wonderful journey.
Yeah.
There's one image in my head.
Yes.
That, you know, it's always wonderful to see you operating with your grandchildren.
Ah,
you operate a bilateral knee and then you put your knife, you put your scalpel down. Can you take
us to that? That was a golden day in my life. I remember 27th of March 2017. Because that is, I finished 50 years of my post-graduation and 40 years of my hospital. And I made a decision that now there are good orthopedic surgeons better than me. And I should now stop operating. Because I found that I was slowing to some extent. And my concentration and problematic cases are more and more because more and more you become senior. So my little two granddaughters, they assisted me. One of them was in final year and other was intern. Could you not believe? I felt so proud. The way they assisted, the way they asked me, I think the last operation in my life, probably the best thing. And when I put the knife down, I remember you said, put it down here. I never lifted up the knife. Now I only use a knife to apply the butter or cut the watermelon. Otherwise, but those are golden days. And I think, Sudhir, family is what makes you. And you need to do, and you know, Sudhir, this COVID taught me one thing. 3 months I felt what I lost 50 years ago.
Wow.
Not whole day. Could I not have spent 2 hours with my young wife, with my parents, sat with them. But the circumstances and environment was such. Luckily, the environment today is very different. So, my dear friends, all of you who are making a career, take this opportunity. Replan your life. Replan your life.
Because I must say that what they lost, all of our students gained.
Yeah, sure.
So and there's one point that also someone has raised as a question, and I remember waking up in a room where I was sharing this room with you in a conference about 15 years ago, and it was 5:30 in the morning, and you had already done your jogging and you were doing Surya Namaskar and exercise in the room. There is a big question as to how do you remain fitter than Harish and me put together at this age, sir?
I don't know whether I am fitter than you and Harish or all other colleagues, but I feel health is wealth. To keep your brain also, to body also, exercise is necessary. So three things are important. When you get up in the morning, look at your both hands. And they say, Karagre Vasati Lakshmi. Karamadde Saraswati, Karamuli to Govinda, Prabhate, Karadashatam. See your hands. Because with hands you move. Second, do your free exercises of all the joints. Let them move. They are meant for that. Must do yoga and breathing exercises to keep your chest circulation very well. And must walk 40 minutes every day. And Sudhir, heavens will fall. Even in Davos, people are surprised with snow boots I used to walk. And I used to jog in my room till the fellow below complained that somebody is dancing because of wooden floor. But I went out and under a tree, I kept on moving. So there is always is a method in madness. You know, I am a mad person, but this is what is my life. I even if it rains, I walk in the house. I have to do that. Otherwise, I feel guilty to eat, Sudhir, do you know? I have guilt complex. And second thing, I have a sugar factory in me. So I'm a diabetic. So it will become mandatory.
The sweetness is flowing from everywhere, sir.
I don't know that.
But sir, one last, I think we're well ahead. I mean, we're almost reaching the end of time. One last question that I'm sure everyone is looking out for is what would your advice be to your colleagues and to the juniors as to how they should live their lives? Just, you know, the mantra of success.
Sudhir, nobody junior, all are my colleagues. They're all qualified. They belong to 1% of this country's elite. Okay, now since you asked me, yes, I have to tell them. In life, always remember, is not the life but quality of life. Number two, there is a conflict between need and greed. Right? So define what is your need. Don't take the greed out of your mind. The reason is very simple. That to achieve what you greed for make money, you unknowingly get into the rat race, end up as a rat. So define your life, plan your life. Keep time, 20% of time in your life for your family, because it's the family which makes you what you are. Second, keep an update the way you can. And third, don't run after a mirage. Don't get carried away with super, super, super speciality unless you are trained with this and very well trained before you any technique, and you control the technology. Technology should not control you, because all of you are elite. All of you are highly educated. But all of you should remember one thing. What Dr. Katra told me, that when in difficulty, try to be godly, don't try to be God. And in difficult situations, learn when to stop. Today, we don't learn when to stop. World is open. Things are very difficult. But if you plan yourself and draw a line, things will be very good. And I'll tell you 7 important things in life. These are the core issues: care, compassion, conscience, collaboration, cooperation, confidence in computer. I thank you. I salute all of you, my friends. I think I had a wonderful time. For me, whenever I get a phone call from you or meet you in the conference, tell me, believe me, I go back 50 years and see you in the apron 40 years. Only thing is, don't ask me your name. My age, I may forget and you may feel bad. So my dear friend, when you meet me, tell me, sir, I'm so and so. I say, okay. Right? So it has been a wonderful evening, and I wish all of you good luck, lot of health, wealth, happiness, and God bless. And I'm really grateful and appreciate Mr. Mishra and your game for, I don't know whether legion, you decide whether I'm a legion or not, but I have known a lot of legends, and thank you very much. This evening I will, in my life, will go down as one of the finest evenings in my life. And thank you, Harish, and thank you, Sudhir, for your interaction. You have been kind many times.
It's our pleasure.
Yeah, you didn't pull my legs, but I was expecting that. But anyway, thank you very much. And thank you, all of you, friends. Thank you. And bye-bye.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Wonderful.